very basic things from unicellular organisms. You learn about plants. Now we move the ladder a bit up to insects. And before that, you've heard about C. elegans. And then after that, you hear more about humans and mice as well. So because this is a biotechnology course, you want to learn a bit about how to control insects. Because as you know, that insects can have really devastating effects on our agriculture and also on humans. So for example, about 1/4 of food production every year is lost by diseases and pests. And a large part of this is due to insects eating this away from us humans. Well, obviously, one part of it is that we have this mass production of crop and other things, and this is really something that favors insect explosion of insect populations. But if they have these ideal conditions and can start one way, then they can spread very rapidly. And you might know that some of the insects, they lay thousands of eggs. And if they all develop, then we have really masses of insects. The other part of it is also that through globalization, we have introduction of non-native species. So if one species comes into another environment where the enemies are missing, they sometimes can spread very rapidly and cause various diseases. So this is the part you've got to look into, how we can control such insects using biotechnological approaches. And you're going to learn a little bit how to make transgenic insects, and how this is done, and what this is used for, with some field applications. So insects, not only do they eat our food, but many of them also spread deadly diseases that are very difficult to control. So insects are so-called vectors, or insect vectors, and they carry diseases. These are other organisms, from viruses, bacteria, protists. There are two main routes how these insects can spread this, and you can see here. These ones, these are blood-sucking insects. If they suck blood, they can transmit viruses, bacteria, and protists like malaria or dengue, also encephalitis. There's another route of infection, and this is through excretions. So this bug here does suck blood, but the bacteria that it will infect its host come from the excretions. So this is another source. Then we can have viruses. I'm not sure if you heard about West Nile fiber, but at some point this was spreading, particularly in the US. It's become a bit more quiet, but there are viruses. They are spread through insects, and they can spread into large areas. Currently, dengue is an important disease that is spreading through mosquitoes. Then we have bacteria, like plague is a very old one that is not extinct. It's still there in some places. Rickettsia is another source of bacteria that is spread. Protists are a prominent group, like Plasmodium or Trypanosoma or Leishmaniasis. These are the diseases that cause malaria, for example, or yellow fever. So they're very widespread, and we don't really have the means to control them. And there's progress made, but not such that we would really control this. And obviously, really a driver for this is globalization. So meaning, we are traveling all around the world, and everybody is traveling around the world, and with people and cargo, insects travel around the world. And so this way, they can be spread. And the other thing that favors spreading currently is climate change. And in particular, what is critical here is winters. So if there are harsh winters, then insects that are non-native are more likely to die. But if winters are very mild, then this favors that such insects can adapt and carry the disease with them. So these are two things that really contribute to distribution of pest insects. So, historically, how we dealt with this is through pesticides. So we spray some toxicants, and this kills the insects. But one of the main problems with insects is that sooner or later they become resistant. So no matter what toxic compound you take, they will become resistant. But if you spray toxins, then this will not only target the bad ones, but also the good ones. So we have a number of insects. Without those, we wouldn't be on this earth. So we have the natural enemies of these insects that are going to spread, but also we have pollinators. So if you kill all the bees, you won't have a lot of things that you find currently in the supermarket. They won't be there. There are no bees. We have soil arthropods. So there's a lot of life in the earth. And if they are dead, then plants can't make use of a lot of resources. And obviously also wildlife. And at the end, it's also toxic to us humans. So the classic example is DDT. It was used in the 40s and 50s, really widespread to ban malaria and typhus. It did kill the insects, but it killed a lot of other things as well. And later has been found is genotoxic to humans. And also affects many predators, for example, birds and fish. So a lot of large birds, they're almost extinct because of this, because the toxin is accumulated in their food chain. And then they would lay eggs that didn't have a shell. So they didn't have any progeny anymore. And DDT was banned just in the right time, so most of these species have recovered. But you can see from this that this has large effects. The other source is fish. So the fish we like most, like tuna, for example, is at the end of the food chain. So if there's lots of toxin in the environment, it will end up in the tuna and other big fish. And the other downside is that it has a very long half-life, up to 30 years. So meaning that after 30 years, half of it is still there. So given the masses that were sprayed, it's probably still toxic to us. And you wouldn't believe it, DDT, although banned in our world, is still used in many places on this world, in this planet, despite its toxicity. Obviously, it's cheap. So currently used pesticides are organophosphates, so these are esters of phosphoric acid. They irreversibly inactivate acetylcholine esterase, and this is an essential enzyme in the nervous system. So all the toxins we have, they target neural transmission. So meaning if the insects are paralyzed, they will be eaten up by others or will simply die. These are part of many toxins, including herbicides and nerve gases. And they can also be made working against humans. Some of them are problematic to humans and have also been banned, like parathion. Another class is carbamates. This reversibly inactivates acetylcholine esterase, but by a different mechanism than organophosphates, but targets the same molecule. So this is really an important enzyme in nerve transmission. Then neonicotinoids, you probably heard about, because they have been banned in certain parts, because they have, or is thought to have an impact on bee populations. They also bind acetylcholine receptor, which is the same pathway. How they are applied is somewhat smart, because they're not sprayed, but the seeds are coated. And so if a seed is coated, it goes into the earth, and then the plant takes up the toxin and distributes it in the leaves. And this way, only the insects that eat the plant will die. But to a small amount, it also goes to the pollinators. But principally, is an interesting use to kind of limit spraying of toxicants. Then pyrethroids is another class. This is an organic compound that is derived from this flower, chrysanthemum, which you can find in every flower shop. A very popular plant. And they have compounds in their leaves that insects don't like. The good thing about these is that they're sensitive to sunlight. So they have a very short half-life. And obviously if they're outside, they will be inactivated. So they're somewhat safer. And again, they will target sodium channels. So this is insect neurotransmission. And because these molecules in insects are a bit different than in us humans, we can get compounds that are highly specific towards insects. But obviously, some of them also can act on humans, as we've seen for organophosphate. So currently, the approach is to use something what is called integrated pest management. So the idea here is that we use an approach that doesn't rely only on one thing, for example, chemicals. So we're trying to have a sustainable approach to manage pests. And this combines, in the first instance, biological ways to control insect population, for example, natural enemies. So a lot of our production is done in greenhouses. And there are companies that produce insects to spread in greenhouses. For example, pollinators, but also certain enemies of insect pests. For example, nematodes. They are spread in these greenhouses to control insects that might spread. We can put up physical traps, meaning put traps in the forest, and can collect insects that are detrimental. Often in these traps, pheromones are used for insects because males are attracted by females from the release of pheromones. If you put these pheromones in the trap, all the males will go to these traps and fall into them and die. Transgenic is another approach. So we make, for example, plants that express toxins that are toxic to insects. And we'll talk a little bit about this. Bt crop. And then, obviously, the other approaches, with the last one, is the chemical one that then is not very specific and kills everything. But, obviously, if you have a huge outbreak of insects, then this is probably what applies as last resort. So, through this integrated pest management, we want to minimize the economic, environmental, and health risks. And obviously, the more we know about about pest insects, the more targeting we can go through. So one aspect of this is knowing about the biology of these insects. And the other is to have technological approaches to get rid of them. So one example is Bt crop. So Bt stands for Bacillus thuringiensis. And in the 60s or so, someone recognized that there was a puddle with lots of dead insects around it. And then they isolated bacteria from there and found out that this bacteria, called Bacillus thuringiensis, produced a toxin that was toxic to insects. Now this toxin is a protein, so we can clone it and put it into a plant. And it's toxic to insects, but not to humans. But even better, this toxin is insect order specific, so they're different of these Bacillus thuringiensis proteins. And some of them will be effective against lepidopterans, like this moth, others against coleopterans, like this beetle here, or hymenopterans, like this wasp larvae, or against dipterans, these flies here, and also against locusts. So we can target our approach to affect only these insects that we don't want. The active ingredients is BT toxin, which is called crystal protein or cry proteins, and they are normally located on plasmids of Bacillus thuringiensis. So bacteria exchange them. But the big advantage of these ones is that they are non-toxic to humans, so they target insects. And this has been used to put these toxins into plants, and then if the insects feed on them, they will die. So, well, the question is this the ultimate solution? You're probably guessing it doesn't work for everything. So, for example, this is not applicable to long-lived plants like fruit trees, olive trees, or pine trees, because we simply can't make transgenic plants of these ones. So this only works with short-lived plants. It doesn't kill sucking insects like aphids, doesn't do them anything, so it's fairly specific to insects that eat the leaves. It's not applicable to disease vectors, so we can't make ourselves transgenic and express BT toxin, for example, but it doesn't work like this. There are also cultural issues with transgenic plants, and some parts of the world think they are not good. And lastly, also resistance has been discovered. So even so, it's a natural way of getting rid of insects. Insects become resistant. But because they are different toxins, they can be exchanged. But when talking about insects, we have to be aware that they can become resistant to it. So another technique that we're going to talk a little bit more is sterile insect technique. And this is something that is currently done in many places of the world. And this works that we have a plane full of insects that are released. They're sprayed over the area. Now, these insects that are released are just males. They are sterile. And these males, they will compete with the wild males. And if they mate, then the female will produce no offspring because these males are not fertile. So this is an important technique that is being used. One aspect is interesting is that in the wild, most female insects, they mate only once. Like mosquitoes, they mate only once. And then refuse other males that want to mate. And part of this is that the males transfer substances in together with sperm that make the females refractory. So, for example, many insects, even ones that live very long, they mate once and then store sperm. For example, bees or some ants that live 20 years, they just mate in the beginning of their life and then store the sperm. So this makes this technique very powerful. There's these females mate with the sterile males, they will not produce any offspring. And then obviously the population will collapse. It won't prevent them from harming the fruit if this is a problem. So they could still cause infections to the fruit, spots in the fruits, which will limit their value. So how this works is that about a hundredfold excess of sterile males will be released. So this means there must be facilities that do mass rearing of these insects. So they first have to be bred before we can release them. So there are facilities that breed billions of flies. Then they are sterilized using gamma irradiation. So they are irradiated, and this will damage the chromosomes. And then they will not have successful progeny. So this is something that is applied to various insects, like New World screwworm, mosquitoes, Anopheles, pink bollworm, which is a moth, and many fruit flies, metfly, maxfly, oriental fruit fly. So because these are fairly easy to breed. But obviously, there are ways to make this more efficient. So one of the limitations is that when the males are released, also females are there. And you can imagine that maybe sterilization is not 100%. So if sterilization is only 99%, we have one female of this 100 that is released compared to a wild type that might have progeny. So this can thin the effect. The other problem that might arise is that irradiation harms the males, so that they are less competitive in the wild, because they're not as fit anymore with irradiation. So one part where transgenic insects come into play is that we want to have genetic sexing systems, so such that what we breed are only males, but no females. So if we do this, for example, with Drosophila, we can do this genetically very easily. There are various ways to do this. Then maybe we want also switch to a genetic way to sterilize this male, rather than using gamma irradiation, because this will not impair the fitness of the males. And then we also need to monitor the population in the wild. So we want to mark these flies that we have released. So these are the three things where we can use genetic engineering to improve this method and make it better. But what we need for this is transgenic insects. So, I'm going to talk a little bit into how we do transgenic insects. So, transgenic insects all started with a piece of DNA like this. This is a transposable element. And I'm sure you know that most parts of our genome is derived from transposable elements that have spread in the genome. So every organism has those, they're normally silent. But some of them have all the ingredients to be active. And this includes a piece of DNA that has two ends that are so-called terminal repeats, or inverted terminal repeats, and they're specific to certain transposons. And in the middle is an enzyme called the transposase that will make this transposon to move around. Basically, this is just an enzyme that will help to replicate this. We have to cut this out and insert it in another position. So this transposable element called piggyback
has been found in a moth called Trichoplasia knee, and has been discovered in the cell line in the early 80s. And how this was discovered is that it jumped into a baculovirus that has been used to express proteins and inserted there. The length is about 2.5 kb. It has these inverted terminal repeats, which is identical sequence on each end, and then also another element called inverted repeats. Then in the middle, it has an open reading frame, which is a 1.8 kb transposase. And this transposase will make that the whole element is cut out and inserted again, and it uses this sequence recognition element, TTAA, which means that this transposon can insert almost everywhere because these sequences are really abundant. So we find them in many places. Now, if we were to replace what is in the middle of this transposon and just use these inverted repeats, we can put anything in there and make it integrate into the insect genome as long as we provide transposase. So the trick is to put this in the insect, and how we do this is we use a transposase that is only transiently present and then is removed. And then the transposon is in the insect genome. So how we do this is we make a plasmid that we amplify in bacteria, and for example, we put in a gene that codes for the red eye color. And then we have a mutant that has this gene mutated and has white eyes. But as soon as we put this gene into this fly, we'll be getting red eyes. This is one of the markers, one of the oldest markers. But then we can also put in our gene of interest in this vector. So anything else we want. Okay, this plasmid alone won't do anything if we inject it into an embryo. But what we need is another plasmid that just expresses the transposase. This is called the helper. This is the vector. So we mix these two plasmids, inject it into embryos, and then we'll get a fly that is a chimera. Everybody knows what a chimera is? What is it?
It's got DNA from two different organisms or species.
What is this?
Is it got DNA from two different species or organisms?
Yeah, it's a mosaic of different genetic material. So this animal has integrated this plasmid. Yeah?
Can you software express DNA from plasmids?
Of course, yes.
To work in humans?
Yeah, every cell, if you put the plasmid as a promoter in there, in it will express it. Okay. Yeah, the only thing you need is a promoter and a protein, and if this is on a plasmid, it will work. Yeah, so this fly here has integrated this vector into the genome in many different places, hopefully. And what is important is that this is integrated in the germline. So these are these cells that will make eggs or sperm. And if it is integrated in a genome that will go into an egg or sperm, and then this fly is mated, then we can get a fly where this transposon is present in every cell. This is the critical step you need to understand. Yeah, that this DNA that is inserted here is randomly inserted in many places in the genome, hopefully, but where it needs to go is into the germline. Because from the germline, there are cells going to be made that have just one copy of the genome. Because they are haploid. And if you have the transgene present in a haploid genome, then we can propagate it into an entire fly. This is very important to understand. And then we get a transgenic fly that has this insert. So this is an example of such a transgenic fly. This has been made. In here was a gene for the mini white and a GFP protein. So you can see here that this is a normal wild type fly, which has white eyes. And then if you put in the mini white, they get not as dark red eye color as the wild type, but kind of orangey eyes. Because the mini white is not as well functioned. And the other gene we can see is the GFP. So these flies are now green. So we can have a marker that is independent of the background of the insect. So we don't need to have mutants first. We can just use GFP. Inject the plasmid and recover the transgene. So this actually has been used to mark insects in the wild. So if you want to monitor the effectiveness of our method, we need to have such markers. And for this, different traps have been tested. For example, one which has a borax yeast solution or a polypropylene glycol solution. And you can see that even after 3 weeks in a field liquid trap, the GFP is still functional. You can see it. So it's a very powerful method to monitor the effectiveness of transgenic insects in the wild, because it is so stable. So this is a method where we use transgenic insects to monitor how much they have spread in the wild. So now we want to talk a little bit how to make a transgene where we can insert something to manipulate the insects. And obviously we want to make this such that this transposon cannot be remobilized. So if you look at this one here, if there were a transposase present in these flies, then this transgene would start to move around in insects and potentially could do something else, unwanted. So now we're going to look into how to make a transgenic insect that is stable forever. So you can see here a number of insects where fluorescent proteins have been used as markers, like moths, mosquitoes, and flies. And part of this, that this works, is we use an artificial promoter, 3XP3, that works in many insect species. And we just drive a fluorescent protein in the eye. We can recognize it. Then we have this construct that has the inverted repeats. And then we have the fluorescent marker flanked with FRT sites. These are sites from yeast that are used in yeast for recombination. And I'm going to explain this in a second. So this is called a recombinase-mediated cassette exchange. So meaning that this cassette is going to be exchanged. So by bringing this construct into a fly or an insect, we are generating a landing site. We're going to insert this into an insect and select for ones that don't have a compromised fitness. For example, we don't want to insert this gene in a vital locus, because then it can only be heterozygous. So we want to be in the genome such that the fitness of the insect is not compromised. Yeah? So we put this in insects by injection, as shown before, and then we select for transform. Then we take these insects again and inject another construct. It looks like this. So to be able to recognize that the exchange has happened, we need a different marker. So for example, we go from a blue marker to a yellow marker. Then what we have in here is the FRT sites, because we're going to get recombination between these FRT sites. We also want this three-prime inverted repeat, that you will see at the end why you have to put this one in, and then our gene of interest. So this is the vector. Then we inject flip recombinase, which is an enzyme from yeast, and this will make the recombination between these two sites. So it uses this short DNA sequence to do the recombination. And then we end up with this construct. So the CFP has been replaced by YFP, and we put in our gene of interest. And we can screen again for these insects, because they now have yellow eyes. Yeah, so now we have this transposon in the fly. But you can see that it still has the elements from the transposon that can potentially make it move around. So now we want to modify this such that this transposon can't move around. What we do here is we inject a transposase that would remove this transposon. So in many instances, we'll be losing the whole thing because the transposase will cut at the end. But if it takes this three-prime end, then our gene of interest will be in there and we can test that. So what we end up is it's just our gene of interest, which has this little bit of sequence there, but this part is no longer able to be mobilized by a transposase. So it's a stable insert in the insect. So it can't move around. And this is the approach that is currently used to make transgenic insects, but can also be used, for example, to make transgenic plants, right? Any other transgenic animal. So what this is used is for insect transgenesis, for sterile insect technique, or RIDDLE. So this is a new approach, which we're going to discuss in a minute, and this stands for release of insects carrying a dominant lethal. This is currently done by a company in Oxford, and they have been very successful applying this to many places in the world. So they're releasing insects that, when they're made, produce lethal offspring. And this obviously is very efficient in controlling insect species. So what these transgenic strains, for example, for these two species, caryfly and nextfly, have been used is for genetic marking, for genetic sexing, so that we have only males, and then also to make males sterile or to result in embryonic lethality. So one genetic trick to apply to make, for example, only males is to use the mechanism that is used for sex determination. So obviously sex determination is very robust, and in some insects relies on alternative splicing. For example, in fruit flies, females use this splice to make the protein called transformer, and is only present in females. While in males, this exon is included, and this encodes a stop codon. But if you would take this cassette and put the lethal effector on it, then it will kill all the females. And because this is naturally used for sex determination, it's a very robust regulation. So it won't compromise the fitness of the males. But this is one way to have a cassette that is lethal in one sex but not the other. So genes that normally used here are, for example, involved in apoptosis. So this is a cellular suicide program. So every cell in our body has proteins that can make it die. But obviously they're normally controlled and not expressed. Otherwise, you wouldn't be living. But if these proteins are ectopically expressed, it will make the cells die. And so the organism will die. Then we can also have a controllable promoter, which I'm shortly going to talk about, is, for example, TET off promoter. So meaning that when you remove tetracycline, this would become expressed. So sex determination is one way to express a gene in only one sex. But you might know, for example, yolk proteins are only expressed in females as well. And so there are many other tricks that can be used. But obviously, requires that you know the biology of these insects. So if you don't know the biology, you don't have tools to deal with this. So what is currently used for Riddle is this system here. So we have a cell death gene that's under the TET activator, and then we express the TET activator under embryo-specific promoter. So in the release conditions, this promoter will drive the TET activator, this will bind the upstream region, and then the cell death protein HIT is expressed, and this will kill the fly. Obviously, if this were active, we would never get the fly. So we need a trick to control this. And the trick is that we can add the tetracycline, and then this transcriptional activator is inactive. So as long as tetracycline present, this death gene is not expressed, and the flies are alive. So for example, in the laboratory, we just put tetracycline in the food, and then these animals are alive. But when we want to release them, we remove the tetracycline, and then all the progeny will be dead, because this will be spread. So this is what is called RIDDLE, release of insects carrying a dominant lead. These are the two constructs that are engineered into many insects. Have a look at their website. There's a lot of useful information what they're doing. And they're applying this technology to many places. One of the first ones was on the Cayman Island, where genetically modified Aedes mosquitoes were released to eradicate dengue fever. So dengue is a viral infection, there is no vaccination, and it's spreading north. So has been found in places in the US and probably can spread to Europe as well. And in particular, there are a number of mosquito species that are spreading in Europe, so we soon might be facing other diseases that potentially can be controlled with this technique. There is a little review about this topic, but if you look in the literature, you will find many examples of where this has been applied. For example, it has also been commonly used to control Zika virus spreading in Brazil, and many other applications. So stay tuned for these new things and have a look at the Oxitec webpage to see how this is currently used. And so this all depends on being able to genetically modify insects. This is a biotechnological applications that we can use for pest control. So we're going to stop here. Are there any questions? Everything clear? Good. So we'll meet tomorrow for the database workshop. As I mentioned, you don't have to print out anything. I'll bring you a handout for this. And then we look into various databases on what information we can retrieve from there.